hear your word and feast together. You are Rabboni, or teacher, our guide. Come speak to us that we might be messengers of your love and doers of your word. Amen. Our gospel comes from the 20th chapter of John, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." And Peter and the other disciples set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." And she said that she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended into heaven. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." She told them that he had said these things to her. Three Unitarians just died and are at the pearly gates, and St. Peter tells them that they can enter heaven if they can answer one simple question. Peter asks the first Unitarian, "What is Easter?" First one says, "Oh, that's easy. It's the holiday in November when everybody gets together, eats turkey, and is thankful." "Wrong," says Peter, and proceeds to ask the second person the same question. "What is Easter?" The second Unitarian replies, "No, Easter is the holiday in December when we put up an ice tree, exchange presents, and celebrate the birth of Santa Claus." Peter looks at the second Unitarian and shakes his head in disgust. Goes to the third Unitarian and asks, "What is Easter?" The third person smiles and looks Peter in the eye and says, "I know what Easter is. Easter is a Christian holiday that coincides with the Jewish celebration of Passover. Jesus and the disciples were eating at the Last Supper, and he was later deceived and turned over to the Romans by Judas over the disciples. The Romans took him to Pontius Pilate, made him wear a crown of thorns, and he was hung on a cross. He was buried in a nearby cave, which was sealed off by a large pool. Every year the boulder is moved aside so that Jesus can come out. And if he sees his shadow, there will be six more weeks of winter." It's been a while since I've done a bit of joke, so happy Easter. The first Easter experience is somewhat lackluster, especially in the lives of those first responders. The story involves three persons who were followers of Jesus: Mary Magdalene, Peter, and the beloved disciple are the first to the tomb in the disciples' mourning. John doesn't tell us why Mary comes. Maybe she's there to grieve. Maybe she comes to remember and give thanks for the life of the Savior who had changed her life forever. Maybe Mary comes because she needs some time alone to think, to sort out what the past few days, events meant The disciple looks at the same scene, and the scripture tells us he believes.
And they go home.
Mary, now encouraged by the boldness of the other two, wants to take a look for herself. She too sees the place, only now there are two angels, one sitting at the foot of where Jesus had been and the other at the head. "Who are you looking for?" asks one of the angels, and Mary begs him to tell her where they've taken Jesus' body. As she turns around, she sees Jesus but does not recognize him. She supposes he's the gardener and asks him if he knows where they have taken the body. If he will but tell her, she will go and get the body. Jesus then calls her by name. Immediately, she recognizes him. Jesus then instructs her not to touch him and to go and tell his followers, which she does. It's a strange and mysterious story. The greatest event in human history is dramatically unfolding, and the first three eyewitnesses have very strange and mixed responses at best. Mary reduces it to grave robbing. The beloved disciple sees and believes. Peter, he sees and sees nothing. After witnessing the empty tomb, Peter and John, they just go home. Where's all the hype? The celebration? The reality of the fact that what Jesus predicted happened. No party, no ticker tape parade, no news coverage, nothing. Buckets, nada. Isn't this just like God? It seems God has God's way of working in human history. This story sounds very familiar. Just several years early in the evening, the Son of God was born in the world in a stable. Few folks showed up, but in the light of the magnitude of the event, not much response from the world there either. Again, God does what God does in the time and way God deems necessary. Maybe the message in this Easter season is for us to follow God, to be who God is, to do what God does, and in the time God deems necessary in our lives. Maybe that is the real power of the story. God acting in history to change the shape and movement of the world, and people just responding in such different ways, trying to grasp all that God is doing. The older I get, yes, I'm almost 40. The older I get, the more comfortable I become with allowing God to be God. I say now, more than ever, what I admit when I was younger, I just don't know. I'm coming to realize that maybe knowing isn't what this faith business is all about in the first place. Maybe what this really is about is what God is doing and the power of my just trusting it and giving the freedom to do what it needs to do in my life and to lead me where it needs to lead me. When I was a kid, I didn't really ever learn how to swim. I wasn't not necessarily afraid of water, but for one reason or another, I just didn't know. Not long after I joined the Y here in town, about 4 years ago, I began running. And as I was training for different events, I kept reading about how I needed to do some cross training so my body would become too used to doing the same thing. I decided there was no time like the present to learn how to swim. I joined the adult swim class, and there were about six of us in the class, and I think I was the second youngest. When it came time to treading water in the deep end of the pool, we learned a lot about why people drown. They're afraid. Turns out that most drownings happen because people begin to freak out. Our bodies are designed to just float to the top. We just need to trust in the way that God had made us. Easier said than done. I did learn how to swim, though, and I finally found that I really enjoyed it. So, when it came to my first triathlon, I was ready. I was excited. And when the gun sounded and I used all of my skills, I learned to make that half-mile trek around the lake, I felt great. And then about halfway there, I got my bearings and looked for the shore. Wow. Boy, is that far away. So I started to get anxious. I started to panic. My breathing was all messed up, and suddenly I didn't know what I was doing anymore. Which honestly was too bad, since I was actually at the furthest point out from the shoreline. And then I remembered what my teacher taught me. Slowed myself down, trusted what I knew of God's design, and finished the race without incident. The movement of God in the world seems to be like that. God is moving and working at God's pace, in God's time, and in God's direction. Maybe our response needs to be to keep our heads up, trust in what God is doing, enjoy the ride a little. John just saw and believed. Peter looked in and saw nothing. Mary recognized Jesus only after he spoke her name. You know what? God loves us no matter what our response is. That's some pretty good news in this story. God brings resurrection because of who God is. The reality of the empty tomb reminds us God is at work in the world doing what only God can do. In all humility, without much fanfare, and certainly not dependent on the response of the people, God goes about God's business. Our lives and the life of the world will never be the same again. Mary came looking for the Jesus who had died. Peter and John came looking in response to news of a possible grave robbing of Jesus' body. Why have we, you and I, why have we come today? As we are in this sacred space, who is it that we're looking for? Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for this glorious day, for this beautiful day and the beautiful people in the pews. God, we pray that you bless us with the possibility of new life that Jesus has given us in the resurrection. Help us to look around and see that you are there. Help us to stop, let you do your thing, and we be a part of it. In the name of Christ Jesus, who is our Savior. Amen.